Students, good morning. In yesterday's class, we completed structure of plastids. Okay, in detail, we have studied structure of chloroplast. I hope you all have understood what are plastids and what is the detailed structure of chloroplast. I have told you to read NCERT also. So, if you have any doubt in that part, okay, you just tell me. I will explain that part if it is required. Fine. In today's part, we are going to study detailed structure of one of the important cell organelle, that is mitochondria. Fine. So without wasting our time, let's start the next cell organelle, that is mitochondria. Okay. Mitochondria. Fine. Everyone, it is well familiar with this cell organelle because from many standards you are studying this as a powerhouse of cell. We call mitochondria it as a powerhouse of cell. Why we call it as powerhouse of cell? Because it is a site where energy it is produced, energy it is stored in the form of ATP. ATP, it is a currency of cell. So those ATPs are generated, are produced in this cell organelle, that is mitochondria. Okay, let's have some information, some general information related to mitochondria. After that, we will study its ultrastructure and its function. Fine, chalo. So let's see some general things. First one, the term mitochondria, it has derived from two words. First one, mitos. Okay, the meaning of term mitos, that is thread. Okay, and chondria, that is granules. Fine. So these mitochondria, these are thread like, these are filamentous granules which are present in all types of eukaryotic cell. I would like to recall one point here. In case of chloroplast, we have seen that chloroplasts are present only in plant cells, okay? Whereas these mitochondria, they are present in plants as well as in animal cells, okay? So mitochondria are found in all eukaryotic cells, plant cells and animal cells, except mature RBCs. In case of mature RBCs, these mitochondria are absent, right? So these are thread-like granules, okay, found in cytoplasm of, found in cytoplasm of all eukaryotic cells, all eukaryotic cells, that is plants and animals, okay, except mature RBCs, your red blood corpuscles, okay, they do not have this mitochondria. Why they don't have mitochondria? Because they are going to accommodate large number of oxygen, large number of hemoglobin. So for that, most of the cell organelles are degenerated so that more amount of oxygen or hemoglobin will be accommodated. So these are the thread-like granules. Mitochondria are thread-like granules which are present in cytoplasm of eukaryotic cell. Fine. Again, one important point we will discuss. I am making it star. Mesosomes of bacteria. If you recall the structure of bacteria, in that there is the infoldings of inner membrane. The membrane of bacteria, at some places it shows inner foldings. These foldings we call it as mesosomes. These mesosomes show presence of respiratory proteins. Yes, so respiratory chain, electron transport chain, it is located on the membrane of bacteria. So these mesosomes, these are analogous to the eukaryotic mitochondria. Fine. So we will mention this point. Mesosomes of bacteria, mesosomes of bacteria are analogous to eukaryotic mitochondria. Very important point. What is mean by analogous structure? okay, functionally similar, structurally different. Yes, analogous means both the structure they are involved in the respiration, okay, in case of oxygen consumption or the process of respiration, it is performed by mesosome. In case of bacteria, these mesosomes are nothing but these are the foldings of membrane. Okay, respiratory pigments, respiratory proteins, okay, enzymes are located on this membrane. Okay, enzymes of electron transport chain, enzymes of respiration are located on this mesosome. So these bacterial mesosomes, these are analogous to the eukaryotic mitochondria. Fine. Next point. These mitochondria were first observed by Kolliker in muscle cells. Okay, where first these mitochondria were first observed by Kolliker in 1850 in muscle cells. Okay, as he observed them in muscle cell, he called this cell organelle as sarcosomes and called them sarcosomes. He did not call them as mitochondria, as they were present in muscle cells. Okay, he called these structures as sarcosome. So they were first observed by Kolliker in muscle cells and called them as sarcosomes. Fine. Now these mitochondria, they are also called as bioplasts. Mitochondria are also called as bioplast by Altman. Okay, so he called these structures as bioplast by Altman in 1886. Fine. The term mitochondria was given by Benda. Okay. Term mitochondria was given by Benda in 1897. Okay, these things you have to remember. So wherever it is essential, I will tell you that these scientists' name or discoveries years, and you have to remember. Fine. So these three things related to discovery of mitochondria, they were first observed by Kolliker in 1850 in muscle cells. Okay, and he called those structures as sarcosomes. Fine. Later on, Altman called them as bioplast. Okay, in 1886, whereas term mitochondria was given by Benda in 1897. Fine. These much names you have to remember. Later on. Okay. Now let's have some more information about this. Now, as these are the cytoplasmic structures, how we can observe them? So these cytoplasmic structures can be stained with the help of a specific staining. So first time, Michaelis used one stain to observe these mitochondria in living cell. So he used Janus Green B stain to observe this mitochondria in living cell. So this is very important point. Question can come on this part. Okay. So Michaelis in 1900 used Janus Green B. This name you have to remember, Janus Green B, as a vital stain, to observe mitochondria in living cells. Again, I am making star to this point. This point, it is important. Question can come in many reference book questions I have asked on this point. that Michaelis in 1900, he used one stain, okay, to visualize, to observe this mitochondria in a living cell. So the name of that stain, that is Janus Green B. Fine, this you have to remember, Janus Green B. This stain can be used to visualize this mitochondria in a living cell. Fine, so these are some things. After this, we'll study the morphology of mitochondria related to its size, related to its shape, number, okay, its chemical composition, and then we will move toward its ultrastructure. Fine. So, first of all, let's study the morphology of mitochondria. Okay, what is the function of this mitochondria? This mitochondria help in cellular respiration, generation of energy. Mitochondria are called as powerhouse of cell. ATPs which are generated, okay, these ATPs are stored, yes, so these ATPs are stored, and whenever it is required by the cell, these ATPs are released. Okay, or these ATPs are broken down, at that time energy it is released, and this energy it is used to do, okay, all the metabolic activities of cell. Okay, so mitochondria, it is actively involved in the generation of energy, so we call it as a powerhouse of cell. Fine. Now let's study the morphology of mitochondria. Morphology of mitochondria. Okay, first we will discuss about size and shape. Okay, about size and shape. Okay, now if we consider the shape, already we have discussed it is a thread shape, but it can range or it can vary. It may be small cylindrical, okay, or it could be a sausage shape, okay, and in some cells it may be in the form of a thread like structure. Fine. So its shape also varies. So whenever there is a variation in the shape, we call it as a pleomorphy. Whenever it is shape, it is not fixed, it shows multiple shapes. So the word which we use for that, that is known as pleomorphy. So its shape, it could be cylindrical, it could be sausage shape, in some it could be oval. Oval, sausage shape, sausage to cylindrical, cylindrical in shape, cylindrical in shape. Okay, it is pleomorphic. Pleomorphic. It is known as pleomorphic. Whenever any cell or any structure, it does not have a particular structure, morphologically it has many forms, so we call it as a pleomorphic. Okay, so it is pleomorphic. Okay, if we consider its size, its average diameter is about 0.5 to 2 micrometer. Okay, diameter is about 0.5 micrometer in diameter and about 1 micrometer to 4 micrometer in length. Okay, its size about 0.2 to 0.5 micrometer in thickness and about 1 to 4 micrometer in length. Fine. So this is about size and shape. Now if we see number, okay, number of mitochondria, again this is a significant point for your mitochondria, because number of mitochondria varies from cell to cell. Number of mitochondria depends upon metabolic activities of cell. Okay. Now in our body, muscle cells are continuously working. These are the highly active cells, because throughout the day continuously we have muscular movement. So for that, large amount of energy is required. So mitochondria of muscle cells, they are highly active, or muscle cells require large amount of energy. So number of mitochondria are highest in muscle cells. Fine. Though the cells which are less metabolically active, they have less number of mitochondria. Okay, so number of mitochondria varies from cell to cell. It could be one in a unicellular algae, that is a microcystis. Microcystis, it is a green alga, in that there is only one mitochondria. It could range up to few hundred also. Yes. So number of mitochondria varies from cell to cell, but number of mitochondria is higher in those cells which are actively involved in metabolic reactions, where large amount of energy is required. Those cells which are metabolically less active, they have less number of mitochondria. Fine. So these points we will mention. Number vary from cell to cell, but it depends upon metabolic activity of cell. It depends upon metabolic activity of cell. Okay, so muscle cells have maximum number of mitochondria. Muscle cells have maximum number of mitochondria. Some examples we will mention. In case of microcystis, it is a green alga, microcystis. Okay, it has only one microstereas. Okay, it has only one mitochondria. Okay, in case of yeast cell, there are about 10 mitochondria. In case of kidney cell, there are 300 to 400 mitochondria. In liver, nearly 500 mitochondria per cell. In case of flight muscle cells, nearly 5 lakhs mitochondria are present in birds. In case of flight muscle cells, okay, nearly 5 lakhs. Okay, mitochondria. Whereas in case of giant amoeba, there are nearly 50,000 giant amoeba. Okay, it has nearly 50,000 mitochondria. So it doesn't depend upon the size of a cell, it depends upon the metabolic activity of cell. Fine. So number greatly varies from cell to cell. It depends upon the metabolic activities of cell. Fine. So this is about the size, shape and number. After this, we'll see what is the chemical composition. Chemical composition of a mitochondria. How much amount of protein, how much amount of lipids are present in a cell. Okay. So give next heading, that is chemical composition. Okay. We'll mention some points in that. Chemical composition. Okay. Now, one point that we know, that these type of cell organelle, it is involved in respiration. Okay. That is also called as oxidative phosphorylation. Yes. So all the reactions of respiration, they are enzyme based reactions. So all enzymes which are required for aerobic respiration, they are present in mitochondria. So mitochondria consist of abundant of enzymes which are involved in oxidative phosphorylation or aerobic respiration. Then chemical composition. Mitochondria consist of about 70% of proteins 70% proteins, 20 to 25% lipids. If we see the overall composition of mitochondria, including its different structures, then it consists of 70% proteins and nearly 20 to 25% lipids. Right? Besides this, now out of total lipids, 90% are phospholipids, 90% are phospholipids, 10% carotenoids, 10% are carotenoids, okay, small amount of cholesterol and vitamin E. Okay, so if there is 20 to 25% of lipids, in that the abundant or the major amount it is of phospholipid, because as you know that phospholipid it is a component of cell membrane. So there are 90% of phospholipids, along with that there is a carotenoids, there is cholesterol and small amount of vitamin E. Then there is 0.5% RNA. This point we will describe again. 0.5% of RNA, traces of DNA. There is 1 to 2 copies of DNA, traces of DNA, usually 1 to 2 copies of circular DNA. Fine. Then mitochondria comprises of about 1% of total cellular DNA. It comprises of 1% of total cellular DNA. Okay, this DNA, it is known as mitochondrial DNA, that we will see later on. Okay, comprises about 1% of total DNA. Okay, then mitochondria contain enzymes for oxidative phosphorylation. Okay, as I discussed before, it is a site of respiration, cellular respiration. All reactions of cellular respiration are mediated by different enzymes. We will learn this process in detail, okay, in the lesson of respiration. So all these enzymes are located in mitochondria. Okay, so it consists of, mitochondria contain enzymes for oxidative phosphorylation as well as electron transfer. Okay, so all enzymes, all proteins required for oxidative phosphorylation and electron transfer. What is this oxidative phosphorylation? That I will explain again when we study the ultrastructure of mitochondria. Oxidative phosphorylation and electron transport. As respiration, it is you can say it is a universal process, or it is significant for each and every cell. A cell cannot survive without energy. Cell cannot survive without respiration. Okay. So nearly 70% of total enzymes which are present in cell, they are present only in mitochondria. Okay. Suppose a cell has total of 100 enzymes. So from that 70% enzymes are present only in mitochondria, okay, to offer the very important process of respiration. Okay, a living organism cannot survive without respiration. Okay, so 70% of cell's total enzyme, 70% of cell's total enzymes are present in mitochondria. Okay, 70% of total enzymes, they are present in mitochondria. Fine. Now this is the chemical composition of mitochondria. Okay. I hope you have understood. This is very easy part. Not much complications are there in this. Now we will move toward the ultrastructure of mitochondria. This is somewhat important point. Okay. So just like yesterday, we are going to draw a big diagram. Okay. In that we will mention all the essential things. So again, no need to write down anything for that. Fine. So now let's study what is the ultrastructure of mitochondria. Okay. Ultrastructure of mitochondria. So just like yesterday, we will draw ultrastructure of mitochondria. Again, you have to use one horizontal page. On that, you draw the diagram and you mention all the essential things. Fine. Now, as we know that mitochondria, it is enveloped by two membranes. There is an outer membrane and there is an inner membrane. Yesterday while studying the structure of chloroplast, I told you that chloroplast as well as mitochondria, these two cell organelles are known as semi-autonomous. Why? Because they have circular DNA in it, and that is of 70S type. Fine. Just try to remember this. This point is very important, that you have to keep this thing in mind, that chloroplast as well as mitochondria, these two cell organelles are said to be semi-autonomous. Why are they called semi-autonomous? Because they have their own DNA content. Okay? Like chloroplast, mitochondria also possess a circular DNA. That DNA is known as mitochondrial DNA. Okay, so this mitochondrial DNA, it is circular. In mitochondria, there could be 1 to 2 copies of circular DNA. Fine. Along with DNA, it also has all the machineries required for protein synthesis. So now the membrane which is present on outer side, this is called as outer membrane. Okay. So it is enveloped by two membranes. Okay. This is known as outer membrane. Okay. Outer membrane, it is smooth, it is continuous. As I told you, we are going to write all the things here, but I will mention those things slightly later. The outer membrane, it is continuous. Okay. Whereas inner membrane, it shows infoldings, yes, to increase the surface area. Okay, this you have learned in your previous standards also. Okay, the outer membrane, it is smooth, it is continuous. Okay, and whereas inner membrane, it shows infoldings to increase the surface area. So outer membrane is smooth. This is our inner membrane. Okay. Inner membrane. Outer membrane and inner membrane. Fine. The space between outer membrane and inner membrane, it is called as outer chamber or intermembranal space. So this space between outer chamber and inner chamber, or the outer membrane and inner membrane, this is known as intermembranal space. Intermembranal space, or it is also known as outer chamber. Okay, outer chamber. Fine. Outer membrane, inner membrane, which encloses the intermembranal space, it is also called as outer chamber. Fine. Now let's write down some points for outer membrane. Yes, now outer membrane, it is smooth, it is continuous, smooth and continuous. It is more permeable to electrolytes than inner membrane. Okay, more permeable it is more permeable, okay, to many metabolites, okay, due to presence of some protein channels which are known as porins, okay, due to presence of porins, okay, they are known as porins. These are your protein channels. So outer chamber, it is smooth, it is continuous, it is more permeable to many metabolites due to presence of porins, okay. It also shows presence of, or it has 40% of lipids and 60% proteins. One important point, that cholesterol, it is present on outer surface which is absent on inner surface. So I'll write this point here. I'll just rub this. Cholesterol is present. Okay. So cholesterol is present which is absent on inner membrane. So I'll just rename it inner membrane. Okay, so outer membrane, it is smooth, continuous, it is permeable to many metabolites due to presence of membrane proteins. These are called as porins. This membrane has 40% of lipids and 50% of proteins. Okay, on this membrane cholesterol it is attached. Now what is the significance of cholesterol? It gives stability to the membrane. While studying structure of membrane, we have studied, at some places cholesterol, it is attached in the eukaryotic membrane. It gives additional support as there is a fluid mosaic model. Okay, it is in the form of fluid, semi-fluid. So to give a support, this cholesterol, it is present in between. Then inner membrane, we will write some points for the inner membrane. Present in the form of infoldings. Present in the form of infoldings. Okay. To increase the surface area. Okay. This membrane has 20% lipids and 80% proteins. 20% lipids and 80% protein, and it is rich in cardiolipins. Again, I'll rub this. This membrane is rich in cardiolipins. This cardiolipins, the name was given because its presence was first time detected in heart cells. Okay, so they are also known as cardiolipins. Okay, 20%, and in this case cholesterol is absent. Fine. So outer membrane cholesterol present, inner membrane cholesterol absent. Okay, the space which is enclosed within these two membranes, that is known as intermembranal space, also called as outer chamber. Its width is about 80 to 100 angstrom unit. Okay. And it is filled with different types of coenzyme. Okay. Rich in coenzymes. Some metal ions. Okay. Like magnesium, manganese, some ions like magnesium, manganese, iron, etc. and different enzymes of respiration. Okay, so intermembrane space or outer chamber, its width, okay, or its size is about 80 to 100 angstrom unit. It also consists of some enzymes, okay, required for respiration. It is rich in several coenzymes, then some ions like manganese, magnesium ion, okay, and some enzymes for respiration. So this is the outer part. See, we have not entered inside. Okay, so outer membrane is a clear inner membrane, and there is a intermembrane space. Fine. Now, these infoldings of inner membrane, they are called as cristae. Singularly, we call it as crista. Fine. So this I will write over here. This infolding, okay, is known as crista. Okay, singularly called as crista, many cristae. Now the chamber of mitochondria, which is present inside the inner membrane, it is known as inner chamber. So outer chamber and inner chamber. Okay, inner chamber, again it is filled with matrix, semi-solid jelly like material matrix. Okay, it is present in the inner chamber. Matrix has so many components in it. From that one, that is circular DNA. Okay, so there are 1 to 2 copies of circular DNA. This DNA is called as mitochondrial DNA. DNA, we'll mention these points later on. There is a DNA, there is a RNA. Okay, there are ribosomes also, just like chloroplast. There are ribosomes, and these ribosomes are of 70S type. Okay, ribosomes. Okay, ribosomes. These ribosomes are of 70S type. Fine. We will discuss all the things in detail. RNA, DNA, okay, as well as the cristae. On the surface of this cristae, there are drumstick-like structures, okay, small beaded structure, which are present throughout the surface of inner membrane. These are known as F1 particles or oxyzome, small drumstick like projection. We will see its structure also, its different parts, okay, along with their function. So throughout the surface of cristae, throughout the surface of inner membrane, these are drumstick like structure, drumstick like projections, okay. These structures are called as oxyzomes or F1 particles. Okay, I will label it here so that I can write its information. So this small beaded drumstick like structure having a head and stalk, okay, these are known as oxyzomes. There are some other names also. These are known as elementary particles. Oxyzomes or elementary particles, or F0, F1 particles, F0, F1 particles. Okay, so oxyzomes or F0, F1 particle, they are also known as Fernandez particle, because they were first of all discovered by them. So these are known as oxyzome. This is a site where phosphorylation takes place, means where ATP synthesis takes place. How it takes place, that also we will study. So it is a site where ATP synthesis takes place. So these are known as oxyzomes or elementary particles. Fine. The elementary particles, they are huge in number. Their number, it is nearly 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 6 per cell. Okay. So they are present in millions, okay, per mitochondria. If the number goes from 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 6 also. kind. So these are the different parts, okay, which are present inside the mitochondria. Now we will study it in detail. Okay students, now let's see details of the structures. Already we have labeled all the parts, okay, outer membrane, inner membrane, intermembranous space, which is also called as outer chamber. We have seen all the details related to this. Now let's move to the internal part of mitochondria. As I told you, the inner chamber, it is filled with matrix. It consists of number of enzymes which are required for respiration. I'll slightly explain you some things related to respiration. In case of respiration, we know that respiration, it could be aerobic respiration or anaerobic respiration. Anaerobic respiration takes place in the absence of oxygen. Enzymes for anaerobic respiration, they are present in the cytoplasm. For that, mitochondria are not required. But enzymes of aerobic respiration, in which oxygen it is essential, so those enzymes are located in mitochondria. I think in your previous standards you have learned detailed process of respiration. So one of the step in respiration, that is glycolysis. Yes, glycolysis, where glucose, it is broken down into two molecules of pyruvic acid. Okay, so reactions of glycolysis takes place in cytoplasm. For that, mitochondria are not required. So we call glycolysis as a common pathway for aerobic and anaerobic respiration. Once pyruvic acid it is formed, okay, its further fate, it depends on presence or absence of oxygen. Okay, in case of anaerobic respiration, this pyruvic acid, it is reduced to alcohol, okay, or acetaldehyde, okay, or your lactic acid. So it could undergo lactic acid fermentation or alcoholic fermentation. In case of aerobic respiration, the pyruvic acid which is formed in cytoplasm, it enters into mitochondria and further reactions takes place. These reactions are called as oxidative decarboxylation and Krebs cycle. Details we will learn in the plant physiology respiration lesson. Okay, now just to get idea related with the functions of mitochondria, it is very important to know these basic things related to respiration. So for glycolysis, mitochondria are not required. Okay, once pyruvic acid it is formed, that pyruvic acid enters in mitochondria and it undergoes next steps of the Krebs cycle, where, okay, oxidative phosphorylation, okay, it takes place, ATPs are produced, okay, oxygen it is reduced, okay, it is oxidized, fine. So all these enzymes for aerobic respiration are present in this matrix. So enzymes of Krebs cycles are located in matrix. So we will write here. So this is the matrix, inner chamber, it encloses the matrix, okay, inner chamber encloses matrix, inner chamber, it encloses the matrix, which consists of enzymes for Krebs cycle. Inner chamber encloses matrix, okay, it has enzymes of Krebs cycle. Okay, enzymes of Krebs cycle. This Krebs cycle is also known as TCA cycle, tricarboxyacid cycle. Okay, encloses matrix, which is a fluid, semi-solid fluid like material. Okay, it has enzymes for Krebs cycle. Fine. It also has a DNA copy. As I told you, mitochondria, it is a semi-autonomous cell organelle. Now this DNA, it is circular, okay, there are 1 to 2 copies, circular, it has 1 to 2 copies of DNA, okay, because of this, mitochondria, it is semi-autonomous. Yesterday we discussed chloroplast, okay, and mitochondria, these two are semi-autonomous cell organelles because they have DNA, they have RNA, they have ribosomes, so they can synthesize some proteins or enzymes which are essential for their own functioning. Okay, so called semi-autonomous. So called semi-autonomous. The DNA of mitochondria, it is known as mtDNA or mitochondrial DNA. It is known as mtDNA or mitochondrial DNA. mtDNA or mitochondrial DNA. Fine. Now, along with DNA, there are ribosomes also. Okay. Yesterday we discussed that ribosomes of chloroplast as well as mitochondria, they are of 70S type. So eukaryotic ribosomes, they are 70S type. But again, essential point, in case of mammalian mitochondria, mitochondria of mammalian cells, they are of 50S type. Very important point, mammalian mitochondria or mitochondria which are present in mammals, they are 55S type. Yes, for MCQ, if question comes, if eukaryotic mitochondria, if they ask, then you have to write a 70S type. But if specifically they ask that mammalian mitochondria are of what size, then they are of 55S type with a larger subunit of 38S and smaller subunit is of 28S. Okay, larger subunit is 38S and smaller subunit is 28S. Fine. This keep in mind, students. Eukaryotic mitochondrial DNA, it is 70S type, whereas in case of mammals, okay, in case of mammals, this mitochondrial DNA, it is of 55S with a larger subunit of 38S and smaller subunit is of 28S. One more important thing related to DNA, I forgot to tell you. DNA, mitochondrial DNA can carry some genes which are responsible for some hereditary characters also. Okay, those genes, mitochondrial genes, okay, they are responsible for some hereditary characters. One such example, that is male sterility in males. In case of males, the male sterile or sterility, it is due to mitochondrial genes. Its inheritance pattern, how they are transmitted to the next generation, that we will learn in next year. Okay, so ribosomes are also present. In general, eukaryotic ribosomes are 70S type. Along with ribosome, there is RNA also. Okay, so RNA is also there. Fine. One more important point for DNA, I forgot. In case of mitochondrial DNA, the ratio of cytosine and guanine, it is more. Amount of cytosine and guanine, it is more than adenine and thymine. In previous standards, if you have learned the structure of DNA, the DNA, it is composed of four nucleotides of four types of nitrogenous bases: adenine, guanine, thymine and cytosine. From that, in case of mitochondrial DNA, the ratio of cytosine is to guanine is higher. Okay. Now, what is the significance of this? There are three hydrogen bonds in between cytosine and guanine, whereas there are two hydrogen bonds in adenine and guanine. More the C and G contained, more is the stability. Okay, so it denaturity rate, it is very less. Means if the DNA starts denaturing, DNA starts degenerating, then if the DNA has more amount of adenine and thymine, it can degenerate at a much faster rate. But if it has more of cytosine and the guanine, it degenerates at a lower, so it gives the stability. Okay, so ratio of cytosine and guanine, it is higher. Okay, so there is high denaturation temperature. High denaturation temperature. As we all know that DNA can denature at a high temperature. Okay, so if the DNA has more amount of cytosine and guanine, then it can degenerate at the less or the lower speed. No? So it gives the more stability. No? So this DNA has more of C and G content, and it is responsible for semi-autonomous nature. Fine. The next part we discuss, that is the oxysomes. Oxysome or F1 particles, F0 F1 particles, or elementary particles. Fine. These particles are also known as Fernandez-Morgan particles, because first time discovered by Fernandez-Morgan particles. Okay, also called as Fernandez-Morgan particle, F0, F1 particle. The number ranges from 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 6. Okay, these are concerned with oxidative phosphorylation. Concerned with oxidative, concerned with oxidative phosphorylation. In general, in commonly we call it as ATP synthesis, the process of ATP synthesis. How ATP synthesis takes place, that also we will study. ATP synthesis, its number 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 6. So its number, it is also used about 10 raised to 4 to 10 raised to 6 in number. Okay, they are concerned with oxidative phosphorylation, where ATPs are synthesized. ATPs are known as currency of a cell. Okay, the energy it is stored. This is just try to understand the difference between ATP storage and ATP use. Mitochondria, it is called as powerhouse of cell, because energy is stored. When the complex organic food material, it is broken down into simpler compound, whatever food we are eating, carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, okay, complex organic materials are broken down into simpler compounds, that time energy it is released. The energy which is stored in complex molecules, it is released, and that energy it is stored in the form of strong bonds of ATP. ATP has three bonds. ATP, its full form is adenosine triphosphate. Okay, it has energy rich, high energy rich bonds. So that energy it is stored in the form of ATP. Such ATPs are stored in mitochondria. Whenever cell requires the energy, ATPs are broken down. Means if required, first bond it is broken down, ATP is converted into ADP, that is adenosine diphosphate. Again one bond it is broken down, ADP is converted into AMP, that is adenosine monophosphate. Whenever these bonds are broken down, that time stored energy is released, and that energy it is used by cell. So ATP it is known as currency of cell, whereas mitochondria are known as powerhouse of cell. Fine. If this concept is not clear, just get it clear well. Okay, so that while learning respiration, you will not face any problem. Fine. So these oxysomes, these are the sites where oxidative phosphorylation, that is ATP synthesis, takes place. Okay. So these are the different parts, okay, of mitochondria, ultrastructure of mitochondria. Still we have not seen the structure of single oxysome, that also we are going to study, and we will also study how ATP synthesis takes place. Okay. So after this, we will also learn the ATP synthesis, or how oxidative phosphorylation takes place, okay, and what is the detailed structure of oxysomes. After that, we will also study, okay, what is the similarity in mitochondria and bacteria, if there is any type of similarity, okay, and how these mitochondria are regenerated inside a cell. Okay.
Okay, students,
Till now we have completed structure of mitochondria in detail. We have seen different parts of this mitochondria. Now we are going to study exosomes in detail, because as we know that mitochondria, it is a site of cellular respiration. We call it as a oxidative phosphorylation also. Okay, so oxidative phosphorylation is a process in which ATPs are produced. Phosphorylation takes place. ATP, which is a currency of cell, so these ATPs are produced. For that, all these phosphorylation takes place at exosomes. So it is very important to know, okay, or it is very important to study structure of exosomes in detail. Okay, now let's see what are the different parts of exosomes and how this ATP synthesis takes place in mitochondria. Okay, now already we have studied the structure of mitochondria, so now I am focusing only on structure of exosomes, fine. So these exosomes, as we have discussed, these are the drumstick like structures. Okay, drumstick like small beaded structure where they have three parts. Okay, its base, which is embedded in the inner mitochondrial membrane. This base, okay, base, then there is a stalk and head. Okay, this base is also called as foot. Okay, so there are three parts of exosomes, fine. Yes, we have seen different names of exosomes also. Exosomes can be also called as F0, F1 particles. Okay, these are also known as elementary particles, as well as Fernandez-Morgan particles. Okay, so these are different names for exosomes, fine. It is a site where oxidative phosphorylation takes place, ATPs are produced. So these F0, F1 particles, these elementary particles, they are composed of three parts, fine. Base or foot, stalk and head. Okay, this base and foot, this part, it is known as F0. Okay, whereas head is known as F1. So F0, it is a transmembrane part which is embedded, detail also where exactly it is located on the inner mitochondrial membrane. So F0 and F1, the head of exosome, it acts as an enzyme ATP synthetase. Yes, so it is a site where ADP, that is adenosine diphosphate, is phosphorylated to ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate, fine. So this head, it acts as enzyme ATP synthetase. It catalyzes conversion of ADP into ATP. So this is the structure of exosome, fine. Now we will draw the enlarged view of one of the cristae. We will see where are these exosomes are located and how they form ATP, fine. So I'll rub this part little bit so that I can draw one enlarged diagram, fine. So now let's draw. Now see, here I am drawing one smaller diagram of mitochondria, having outer membrane. The inner membrane has many foldings. Okay, these foldings are known as crista. Okay, singularly it is called as cristae. Okay, plurally we call as cristae, the crista. Then, so the outer chamber and inner chamber. Then on this crista, these are your beaded structures. These structures are known as exosomes, fine. It is a site where ATP synthesis takes place. Now we are going to enlarge a part of only inner mitochondrial membrane, fine. Suppose this is the inner mitochondrial membrane. Outer mitochondrial membrane, okay. this is a single Christie. Okay, now we are drawing only one. As we discussed that outer membrane, it is more permeable to different types of electrolytes because of membrane proteins which are called as porins. So we will also show porins also in this. These are the transmembrane proteins, channel proteins, porins. Okay, so this is your outer membrane. This is outer membrane. Okay, these are porins or protein channels. Okay, this is outer compartment. Outer compartment or outer chamber, we also call it as intermembranal space, the space between outer membrane and the inner membrane. Fine. Now this is inner membrane, and this one is crista. Okay, the folding or the infolding of this membrane, it is known as cristae. Because of this, mitochondria has two phases. Okay, the part which is toward this is known as M phase, that is the side of mitochondria toward the matrix, it is known as M phase. And the part of mitochondria toward the cytoplasm, that is known as C phase. So here there is a C phase. C stand for cytoplasm and M stand for matrix. So here is your inner compartment of mitochondria. Fine. Now we will see where exactly this oxysomes are located. These oxysomes, they are located on inner mitochondrial membrane. So where? Here. Okay. So here are they located. F0 particle, it is embedded inside the membrane. Okay. Whereas F1 particle, it protrudes out, it projects toward the matrix side. Fine. So in this way, these oxysomes, they are embedded throughout the surface of Christie. Along with this, there are many carrier proteins also. Okay, there are so many proteins which are present in between this. Okay, so these proteins, they act as a electron carriers. Fine. They act as a electron carriers. So just try to understand why I'm explaining this now, because if you will understand the structure of mitochondria properly, then while learning respiration, all ideas will be clear in mind. Fine. So these are your elementary particles and these are carrier proteins. So this blue one, these are proteins which help in electron transfer at the time of respiration, whereas these are your oxysomes. Oxysomes or F0, F1 particle. Fine. Now let's see what is happening here or how ATPs are produced. As you know that in case of respiration, there is a sequential breakdown of complex organic material. Okay, suppose I hope you all have learned respiration in your previous standards. So you have little bit information about respiration. Respiration starts with glucose, because glucose, it is the most favorable substrate for respiration. Glucose, it is a 6-carbon compound. Okay, so first it is partially broken down into 2 molecules of pyruvic acid. Pyruvic acid, it is a 3-carbon compound. Fine. That pyruvic acid is converted into acetyl coenzyme A. Okay, by a process of oxidative decarboxylation. Okay, it takes place in the outer chamber of mitochondria. Glycolytic reactions, okay, they occur, or those reactions occur in the cytoplasm. For that, mitochondria it is not required. So I told you yesterday, it is a common pathway for aerobic as well as anaerobic respiration. So once acetyl coenzyme is produced, that acetyl coenzyme undergoes a series of reactions. Okay, during these reactions, okay, different types of energy equivalents are reduced, NADH2, FADH2. These are the zip folders in which energy it is stored, right? Now the energy which is stored in those zip folders have to be released, okay, and that is then converted into ATP, because cell cannot use NADH2 or FADH2. Cells can use only ATP, okay, to obtain the energy. Okay, so those energy equivalent, those redox equivalents, okay, must release their energy. So for that, those redox equivalent, they move through the series of protein channels, okay, or they move through the series of proteins. When they move through this protein, okay, they release protons, okay, and there is a oxygen, okay, oxygen, it is a final acceptor of electron, okay. So at that time, what happened? Those protons, they use to produce the ATP. Just now, to understand how ATPs are produced, I think so you will not be able to get this idea clearly, but I will try to explain it as much I can. As I told you, during Krebs cycle, NADH2 and FADH2 are produced. NADH2 and FADH2, these are the zip folders in which energy it is stored. Cells cannot use the energy which is stored in NADH2 and FADH2 form. That has to be converted in the form of ATP, fine? So to release the energy from NADH2 and FADH2, those redox equivalent, they pass through these protein molecules, okay? These are the membrane bound proteins, from high energy level to low. So while moving, the electrons are transferred. At that time, protons are also produced, okay? So these protons, they accumulate in this part, okay? Protons are accumulate in the intermembranous space, while electrons are transferred toward, yes, oxygen. So there is an accumulation of protons here in the intermembranous space. Fine. Protons are accumulated. Concentration of protons increases, okay, inside the intermembranous space. In a matrix, there is a low concentration of proton. So suppose a membrane has two different concentrations, then it establishes a concentration gradient, fine. Now across this membrane, this side there is a high concentration of protons, inside the matrix there is a lower concentration of protons. So obviously what will happen? Protons will move toward its lower concentration, fine. Now these protons, they have more energy. These are the energy rich protons, these are excited protons, fine. So these protons, they move through membrane, and while moving, they move through this F0 particle. F0, it is a transmembrane protein. It acts as a channel through which these protons, they are moving inside the matrix. Fine. Just try to understand. Inside this outer chamber or in intermembranal space, protons are there which have high energy. Okay, because of its higher concentration, concentration gradient it is established. So these protons, they move from its higher to lower concentration. Now while moving, they move through, okay, this F0, which act as a transmembrane protein, or it act as a channel. Now these high energy protons, when they move through F0 particle, okay, here this F0 act as a, this F1 head act as a ATP synthesis. The energy it is used for phosphorylation of ADP. So ADP plus inorganic phosphate converted into ATP. Okay, so ATP it is released, fine. So in this way ATPs are produced. So ADP inorganic phosphate, they are produced inside the matrix, fine. So high energy protons, they move through F0, okay, and F1 particle, which act as the enzyme ATP synthetase, it phosphorylates ADP into ATP. So in this way ATPs are produced, fine, and then these ATPs are used whenever cell requires the energy. Okay, I hope you all have understood. I will explain this again, fine. F0, F1 particles, oxysome, these are the sites. Okay, obviously these are nothing but these are your protein molecules which are embedded or which function as enzyme. So from that head, these oxysomes, they have three parts: foot or base, stalk and head. Foot, it is embedded inside the membrane, where is head, it is projecting toward the matrix. Head, it is also known as F1 particle, it acts as an enzyme ATP synthetase. Yes, whenever redox equivalence, that is NADH to FADH2, which are produced in glycolysis as well as Krebs cycle, these are nothing but the zip folders which are packed with lot of energy, fine. So when these zip folders, they move through the electron transport chain, so these proteins, they are nothing but they form the respiratory chain. Okay, they form respiratory chain. They move through this chain. That time protons are pumped in the intermembranal space. Okay, because of continuous pumping of proton in intermembranal space, a concentration gradient, it is established across the inner mitochondrial membrane. Obviously now protons will move from higher to lower concentration. These protons, they have lot of energy. So that energy, it is used for phosphorylation of ADP into ATP. Yes, phosphorylation meaning addition of phosphate group. Because already their ADP has two phosphate group, it is adenosine diphosphate. So in that we are adding one more inorganic phosphate, so it becomes adenosine triphosphate, having three energy rich bonds, fine. So here energy currency, that is ATPs are produced, fine. Oxygen act as an electron acceptor, final electron acceptor. Okay, get reduced to form molecular water. As you know that in case of respiration, water, it is a byproduct, water molecule, it is produced, fine. So in this way, this mitochondria, they help in formation of ATPs, fine. I hope you have understood this part. Okay, details of respiration we will learn later on. Okay, so this is the detailed structure. I told you which things you have to remember. Mitochondria, it is also semi-autonomous cell organelle, just like your plastid. It also carries its circular DNA. It has ribosomes. Okay, the DNA, it is known as mitochondrial DNA. Okay, now next part we will see how these mitochondria are formed. Yes, so that is known as biogenesis. Biogenesis, how these mitochondria are produced in cell. Okay, mitochondria cannot be synthesized de novo artificially. They are formed by the fission, just like your bacteria. You know that bacteria reproduce by means of fission. Parent cell splits, and then it gives rise to two daughter cells. In the same way, bacteria also form new, these mitochondria also undergo fission, okay, and they form new bacteria, new mitochondria, fine. So they form by fission, okay, just like bacteria. Okay, now, okay, the next point we will discuss, that is the endosymbiotic origin. How these plastids as well as these mitochondria, they have evolved. Okay, because as we know that prokaryotic cells are the primitive one. Okay, prokaryotic cells had only simple cell organelles. Okay, that is ribosomes. They are single membrane bound. Okay, so how these double membrane bounds got evolved from then, or how these plastids got evolved, so that is known as endosymbiont origin. It is believed that these mitochondria, they are evolved from a bacterial or a prokaryotic cells, because there are some similarities in bacterial cell and in the mitochondria. Okay, we will discuss which are those similarities. So it is thought that these mitochondria, they are evolved from a bacterial or a prokaryotic cells. Mitochondria are thought to be evolved. They are thought to be evolved, from bacterial or prokaryotic cell. Okay, they are thought to be evolved from bacterial prokaryotic cell due to some similarities. Now we will discuss which are those similarities due to some similarities. Let's see the first one. Okay, structure of DNA. You can just recall, in case of plasmid, in case of bacterial DNA, DNA was not linear, that was circular DNA. Yes, in case of eukaryotic cell, DNA, it is linear. Okay, DNA is circular in prokaryotic cell. In plastid as well as in mitochondria, DNA is circular. So that is one similarity. Second one, ribosomes. Ribosomes of plastid as well as mitochondria, they are of 70S type. I discussed yesterday also, in case of all eukaryotic cells, ribosomes are of 80S type. Only ribosomes of chloroplast and mitochondria, they are of 70S type. So that also gave one of the evidence that these mitochondria could have evolved from your prokaryotic or bacterial cell. And the third reason, that is division, fission. Formed by fission, which is considered as a mitotic division, a mitosis. It is not normal mitosis, okay? It is a mitosis. They divide these mitochondria, also divide by means of fission, although it is a cell organelle, but it can divide, okay, by means of fission. So because of these three reasons, it was thought that these mitochondria were evolved from a prokaryotic or bacterial cell. So that is known as endosymbiont origin. Fine. Now the last part from mitochondria, that is function. So now everyone knows the main function of mitochondria is to provide the energy, to produce the energy currency. So only we call mitochondria as a powerhouse of cell. Okay, so we will mention these functions first. Functions of mitochondria. First one, ATP synthesis. Now again, no need to explain about this. ATP synthesis, so we call it as a powerhouse of cell. Second function, in case of sperm, in case of human sperm, in your previous standards you might have learned the structure of human sperm. In that, these mitochondria, they are spirally arranged or helically arranged, that is known as Nebenkern. So they provide the energy for sperm transfer. So in sperm it forms Nebenkern. Its details we will learn next year. Nebenkern, which provides energy which provides energy to for sperm transfer. Provide energy for sperm transfer. Okay, here also its function is to provide the energy, but as it is a special part, it's a modification, so it is known as a Nebenkern. At the time of sperm transfer, lot of energy is required, so that energy it is provided by this Nebenkern. Okay, next process, function thermogenesis. As we know that our body requires lot of energy. There is a regulation of temperature. During respiration, lot of energy it is produced, lot of energy it is generated. So it maintains the body temperature also. So that is known as thermogenesis. Next function, cytoplasmic inheritance. Okay, as I discussed in the previous part, that plastid, that is a chloroplast, as well as mitochondria, they have DNA. Whenever there is a DNA, it has some genes on it. There are some genes which are located on mitochondrial DNA, and they are responsible for a sort of inheritance. These genes can be transferred to the next generation. Such type of inheritance, it is known as cytoplasmic inheritance. For example, there is a male sterility in maize. In case of maize plants, some plants could be sterile, some male plants could be sterile. The genes for the male sterility, they are located on mitochondrial DNA. Next year in the hereditary and variation lesson, we will study this part in detail. Okay, but those genes which are located on mitochondria, they are also responsible for a kind of inheritance that is known as cytoplasmic inheritance. Example, I will mention over here, that is male sterility in maize. Okay, male sterility in maize. Okay, fine. So these are some functions of mitochondria. Okay, so in today's lecture, we have seen the structure of mitochondria in detail, ultrastructure as well as function of mitochondria. Why this structure is very important? Because process of respiration, it depends upon the structure. If you have understood the structure of mitochondria in detail, okay, while learning respiration, you will be able to imagine where all these things are happening. As I told you, for biology, imagination, it is very important because we are dealing with microscopic structures. We are dealing with reactions, okay, those we can't observe with naked eye. So for that, you must imagine those things, in what way these things are happening. Okay, just remember it in your mind in the form of picture or in the form of video. So after this, in the next video, okay, we will start the next cell organelle, that is ribosome. If you have any doubt related to mitochondria, just message me, read the NCERT again properly. Okay, goodbye.